All right, good afternoon. My name is Dan Harmon. I'm a senior program manager in the Windows management team at Microsoft. And I'm here with Mira Rosenberg, also a senior program manager on the Windows management team. And we're going to be talking to you today about automating the breadth of your IT environment. So I want to start off talking, sharing with you some of the things that we hear from customers. We get the opportunity to go and visit with customers on a regular basis. And when we talk with them, we like to know what they like and what they dislike about managing Windows. And typically, when we have these discussions, they come back with a common set of questions about automation and management. We want to share what some of those common questions are, as well as what our responses are to those questions. So the first thing that usually comes up is, why and what should I automate? Usually this is a pretty short discussion. I think most customers readily understand the benefits of automation, that it can lower their costs, that it can save them time, and just in general increase the efficiency of their IT operations. Once we get past the why and what, then we usually have a set of how questions. That includes things like, how do I automate my IT operations? How do I automate hardware operations? Automating across firewalls, how do I do that? And then how do I automate all of my machines? So as we go through this session, we're going to be reviewing these questions and provide our responses to each one of these. So to kind of frame the discussion, I want to talk about, on the Windows manageability team, how we think about management. And this really breaks across three different axes. The first one is the user experience. And we take great pride in user experience, and we have a lot of focus on that. And we want people to be able to say that I have the right tools to get the job done. The second aspect is access. And what we mean by this is that we want people to be able to say that I can manage anything from anywhere. And then where those two pieces, access and user experience, come together, we have automation. And here we want people to be able to say that I can reduce errors, complexity, and repetition through automation. So when we go about planning one of our releases and designing our features, these are the areas that we really try to keep in mind so that we can maximize the value and provide the best possible management experience on Windows. And that leads us to the management stack that we have for managing Windows. We call this the Windows Management Framework. And it starts off at the foundation layer with the automation platform itself. And this includes services and a set of management protocols. When you think about services, an example is BITS, the Background Intelligent Transfer Service. This is the service that underlies Windows Update. It allows you to stream BITS, do file transfers over the network without consuming all the resources on the machine. Then in terms of the management protocols, we have WS Management, WSMAN for short, which is one of the web services protocols, as well as WMI. And these are standards-based protocols that can work against both the OS as well as the hardware, the robust and the network aware. And then on top of those things, we have the actual automation platform. And this is the PowerShell engine. PowerShell is both a scripting language as well as an interactive shell environment. And these two things combine to give you a place, an execution environment, where you can write scripts and you can run them. On top of that automation platform is where we start to build our access layer. And here we have the remote and the multi-machine management pieces. This includes our remote server administration tools, RSAT, as well as PowerShell remoting. And with PowerShell 2.0, we now have ubiquitous remoting, meaning you can run any PowerShell commandlet over our PowerShell remoting. And because we built on WSMAN, it's also firewall friendly. Once we have those pieces in place, now we can start to build really rich user experiences on top of those. And that provides our server management experience. We have a set of graphical tools, Server Manager, the server migration tools, the PowerShell integrated scripting environment. This is a graphical host and editor for PowerShell, where you can author and run and edit PowerShell scripts. And then we also have our best practice analyzers, our BPAs. So those are the solutions. And all these pieces together make up our Windows management framework. And this is the management stack that ships with Windows. All right. With that idea in mind, let's go ahead and talk about our next question, which is, how do I automate my IT operations? And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Mir.
Thank you. Hi. So that's very easy. We just wanted to make it easy to understand. Basically, there are two worlds, the formal and the informal world. On the formal side of things, we have everything about standards, industry standards. So you get to manage your IT environment using the standards that are basically composed of two things. We have schemas and we have protocols. We'll do a walkthrough for like a couple of them today, actually three. And it's a great world. It's awesome, and you can do pretty much everything you want with your management objects. Now, the only thing is it takes some skills, right? You need to make some investments there, go learn it, go understand what things are there, what methods you can use, etc. And the poster child of the formal world is WMI. Now, on the other side, on the informal side of things, sometimes, you just need to get something done. And you're like, okay, I need to get this done. I have no clue how I'm going to do it, but I need it today. So that's where the informal world comes in, and it helps you maybe by downloading scripts from the community or getting help from other admins, doing a quick web search, and by using tools like Windows PowerShell, where you can get the best of all worlds. You can do AD stuff, stuff from .NET, learnings that you have from COM, you glue all of those pieces together and you just make it happen. So as you find new things or as you need to do new tasks or your manager assigns you new things to do, you just, get rolling with that. Another thing is if we start with the formal world in more detail, we have two things, SIM and WMI. SIM stands for Common Information Model. It's one of those standards I was talking about earlier. So there is this group called the DMTF, Distributed Management Task Force. So it's a standard all about management. So you can do things like managing your computers, servers, clients, managing your devices, like printers, routers, etc., networking, even your applications. You can do, as I said before, many, many different things with each of these management objects. And just to make it simple, SIM defines two things. It defines schemas and profiles. Schemas are standard models that you can use to reach those management objects and modify them, configure them, etc. And then the profiles are a collection of these standard models that you can used to do things like, power boot the system, to virtualization, handle processes, etc. Now, on the other hand, WMI is, it actually stands for Windows Management Instrumentation, and it provides you with access to SIM via the DCOM protocol. So that's the way you get to remote to the SIM world on Windows. One of the good things about WMI is that, first of all, it has been around forever. So by now, you have a lot of different WMI providers, both for Windows and for third-party applications, that you can use to manage those objects over DCOM. And another thing is that it allows you to manage using a variety of clients. You can use PowerShell, you can use .NET, C++, or if you're still on VBScript, you can use that. And one more thing I want to mention is that we also have a good integration story between WMI and PowerShell. I remember when I was in TechEd Australia last August, one of the key pieces of feedback I got from customers was, that's great, you have all these pieces, but what's the integration story? Because at the end of the day, we have all of these tools that you gave us, but we need to make them work together. So that's also where we spent some of our time in Windows Server 8, R2, and Windows 7 trying to glue these pieces together. So now you have a consistent user interface, you can use PowerShell to simplify the discovery of WMI objects and the management across all of your applications. So with that, let's get to the demo, because that's what you care about, right? So switch to F. Okay. Great. So let's just do a quick demo, because one of the things we heard from you is you want a little bit more of a walkthrough of how WMI works, how to, you know, do the things that you have to do every day. So first of all, as we said, WMI is this formal way to manage your IT environment in a standard fashion. So we're just using PowerShell here to make it easy to understand, you know, the process, and because of this integration story I mentioned, but this is a pure WMI demo.
Yeah, that's actually a key point. I mean, WMI and SIM, these are formal management tools, management technologies, and, you know, like Mir said, it's a nice world if you can get to it. One of the challenges we've had in the past is that it's been difficult to get access to WMI in an easy way that's easy to understand. And now with PowerShells, we've integrated the two together, provides a really easy-to-use way to get access to all that rich information that's in WMI.
Right, exactly. So first of all, let's say I want to see what's out there. What can I do, right? So a good way to discover the objects that I can manage in WMI is to use the get WMI object commandlet. So here I'm specifying the namespace, let's go with root for now, and the class, and I'm telling it, you know what, sort it, and I want the wide format by property name, and just show it to me in three columns. So just real quick. Here you have all the stuff that you can manage, right? Now, the next thing, one more thing I want to mention is, this is called Start Demo. It's actually a great tool if you want to not just demo PowerShell, WMI, WSMan, but also if you want to teach somebody else or create your own scripts, it's just a great tool. It actually runs the commandlets. This is not, you know, a recording or anything. So now that I know what namespaces are out there, let's just choose SimV2. So I just do like / SimV2 here. And here I see what's inside SimV2. And I can keep going like this forever. Now, the good thing is, as you start using these tools, you learn things every day. We even keep learning now, even if we are in the PowerShell team, every day as we prepare our demos and stuff. So one of the things you'll run into is, oh, by the way, the default namespace is root / SimV2. So I don't really need to specify dash namespace anymore. I can just, you know, go to the namespace class. So I'll get the same information. And with WMI, as we said, there's a ton of stuff you can do, right? This is what we mean by a ton of stuff. That's a good thing about WMI. Since it's been around forever, there's a plethora of things you could do. Basically, anything you want, it's here. So the good thing, again, about the integration between WMI and PowerShell is that we have ways to make this easier. So you can filter, for instance. You can list just the stuff you care about. So let's say you have to manage printers. I can do get WMI object dash list printer, and it will only show me stuff that is related to printers. Only the stuff I care about, only the stuff I actually need to manage. I don't need to manage everything in Windows, right? So another good thing here, integration-wise, is you could create a background job, since this is so much stuff that you can do, right? And I can create a variable here, users, and assign it this get WMI object commandlet. In this case, I'm going to list anything related to users, and I'm going to do that recursively as a background job. So that job is running now. Let's make sure it's actually running. So it says completed now, just because I waited a little bit. And now, let's say, as I said, I actually want to manage these printers. So I have the classes here, and if I want to see what printers I actually have available, I can run this commandlet and I see all of the printers here. These are actual printers back in Redmond. But let's say at this point I want to manage one. So I'm saying, you know what, I just want one that the name has something like XPS, so I can filter by that. Again, another integration point, and I get that printer. I can even, obviously, include the full name, get the same information. Now I'm using the full string. And since that's finally the one I wanted, I assign it to a variable, just like we did before, $printer, that's a variable, and I assign the same command I ran. And now, let's see what I can do with this, right? So for that, we use getMember. This is called a pipeline, so we can say, this is my variable where I have the stuff I want to manage, $printer. Pipe it to getMember and show me just the methods, just the actions I can actually take, I can actually run on these printers. So I can cancel jobs, I can rename it, I can reset, basically everything you want to do with a printer. So if I want to clean up the queue, I just do $printer, my variable, dot cancel all jobs. And now I see, okay, return value, that's true. So that was fine, but in a real world, you actually need to manage many printers, obviously, not just one. So let's do the same thing, but now, so same command I ran before, but now to this variable, printers, I'm going to assign it so it actually looks through many computers. Just for the sake of the demo, to make it simpler, we put localhost and, you know, localhost again. But imagine you can put this, you know, your hundreds, thousands of machines. You can put it in a collection. You don't even need to list it. So once you do that, now I can do $printers, and I see my two printers here. And now I can say for each of those printers, go cancel all jobs. Let's say I need to clean up the queue for all of them. So now I see true for both. And another good thing about WMI, yes, it's formal. Yes, it might be harder to write, but once you learn it, you can pass it a full query using the WQL language, the WMI query language. And I can say, you know what? From all these processes that you have running, select everything where the handle count is greater than 1,000. And format that as a table. Give me the name, the handle count, and, you know, how to size it. So I just get the processes I want that way. By the way, we'll make all these demos available on the PowerShell blog, which is linked to at the end. So no need for typing in case you're interested in any of these steps. You can get them online later. So we can even write to the WMI repository. So for that, instead of the command that we've been using so far, get WMI instance, we use set WMI instance. So that's also, we try to keep it consistent in PowerShell, very easy so you can remember. So I'm going to write to the Win32 environment class this particular variable, take it 2011, variable value, hello Atlanta, and for the system user. So you can see it here, it's actually writing to WMI, take it 2011, and let's actually check that this was written correctly. So you can actually see it here, take it 2011, you can see a system user, and we can delete it. So again, trying to make it simple, remove. Instead of get set, remove WMI object, and you pass it the path you're interested in, and you tell, okay, just delete this thing I care about. And now if I get that WMI object again, you see there is no take it 2011, no Atlanta, nothing. So we have this background job running, it's done. And if we want to receive the results for that WMI command that was running, we just do receive dash job for the user's job, and I get all the information I was collecting in my background job. So you can delete users, you can invalidate the user, or validate it, etc. So that's it for WMI. Now if we go back to the slides.
So again, one thing to reinforce, you know, we show things like the WMI query language and things like that. Those aren't necessarily the only ways to accomplish the task, but we want to let you know that if you've already learned something like WMI and like WMI query language, that you can reuse those skills in the world of PowerShell plus WMI to accomplish the tasks that you want to get done.
Yeah.
All right. All right, so now let's talk about Windows PowerShell. We've been kind of introduced it a little bit with that last demo, but let me go into some more depth on PowerShell. How many of you have used Windows PowerShell so far?
All right. You know, this is fun. Every year we come back to take it, and the number of hands that people raise is much larger. That is just so much fun to see.
Yep. So PowerShell is Microsoft's strategic automation platform. That's the direction we're headed, and that's the direction we're going to continue to head for automating Windows. PowerShell, as I mentioned, it's a revolutionary scripting language. It's like other scripting languages you might have been exposed to in the past, like VBScript or Perl or Python or Ruby, those types of things. It's like that, but it also includes an interactive shell environment where you can execute the scripts, as well as a set of basic commands that come with PowerShell by default. Now, with Windows, we ship two hosts with PowerShell. We have the Windows PowerShell console host. This is the text-based console window when you type PowerShell.exe or you click Windows PowerShell from the start menu. It's the text-based one with the blue background. We also have the integrated scripting environment, the ISE. And again, this is a graphical host where you can not only execute PowerShell commands, but you can also view and author scripts. PowerShell also includes a set of APIs, hosting and extension APIs. And what this allows you to do is if you're writing a management application or even another host, you can use these PowerShell APIs to host the PowerShell engine inside of your application. We also have the ability to extend PowerShell through our APIs, so you can write your own set of commandlets or providers or things like that to extend the capabilities of PowerShell. And then the other thing I want to talk about is PowerShell's extensible type system, the ETS. What this allows us to do is adapt many different type systems and data formats and provide a common user experience for interacting with those things. So for example, we can interact with type systems like COM or .NET or AD, all in a consistent way. We can also access data formats like XML or CSV files or text files, and we can provide a consistent user experience across all of those things so that you learn how to do it once within PowerShell, and then it's common across all those different technologies. And the key point to reinforce is that PowerShell allows you to create your own custom solutions, because we understand that you have unique needs, unique problems that you're trying to solve in your environment, and PowerShell enables you to do that. All right, so starting with PowerShell 2.0, which ships by default in Windows 7 and Windows Server 2008 R2, we've introduced this concept of remote management using PowerShell. And we talk about it in terms of ubiquitous remote management. The idea here is that a given commandlet or script or something doesn't have to implement its own remoting. If you can run it locally, you can then remote it and run it remotely as well. That's what we mean by ubiquitous remoting. So it's local or remote. You can run it on a single machine remotely, or you can run it in what we call a fan-out remoting scenario, which is one-to-many across lots of machines. You can do it in an interactive session where it's as if you were at the remote machine, or you can run it in the background as using our PowerShell jobs infrastructure. We also have eventing support built into PowerShell so that you can subscribe to events and then take some action when those events get fired. And we also support a rich variety of authentication schemes. So that includes, at the WS man level, that includes things like Kerberos, LiveID, Negotiate, Digest, etc. And pretty much with that support, we enable arbitrarily complex network topologies where, for example, you might have to authenticate to a proxy server before you can go and authenticate to the machine you're trying to manage. And then on top of that, we're able to build a delegated administration experience and hosted services. And the key thing here is that you can create a delegated environment where you have control over exactly who can do what in that environment.
And that's actually huge, this new delegated admin support, because one of the key pieces of feedback we get from you is, you know, I have these junior admins or these new people in my company. I don't really trust them yet. I don't want them touching my servers. So what you can do with delegated admin is say, restrict, actually, their environment to just what you want them to do and nothing else. So you have full confidence that they can't mess up your servers or, you know, do something wrong.
All right, with that, let me jump into a PowerShell remoting demo. Okay. So first of all, when you open, this is the PowerShell console host, the blue background. And if you're new to remoting, you can just type help remote, and you can get a list of help topics about remoting. We call these things about topics. They're conceptual content to learn about a specific aspect of PowerShell. Now, when you go to use remoting, it's actually turned off by default, and that's by design so that we're secure. PowerShell ships by default turned on in Windows 7, and so we don't want, you know, the millions of Windows 7 customers who don't really care about using PowerShell. I'm not sure why that would be, but We don't want them using, you know, being exposed to PowerShell by default. So we have remoting turned off. And to enable it, you just type enable PS remoting. And that will go off and it will configure WSMAN, open the firewall ports, and do whatever's necessary to get PowerShell remoting working. I've already done that, so I'm not going to run that command. All right. Then, to get started with remoting, the first command that you want to learn is invoke command. And this is how you can invoke any commandlet on a remote machine. So let's try this out. I'm going to say invoke command computer name. I'm just going to use localhost for the demo purposes. I'm going to pass it a script block. I'm just going to get the processes that start with SVC. Now this is going to take some time, because what it's doing is it's going to go and it's going to create a connection. Then it's going to spin up the CLR, it's going to load the PowerShell engine, it's going to execute that script block in that session, it's going to take the results, return them back, and then it's going to shut down the connection. And it does that every time you call invoke command. There's no persistence going on. It's kind of a fire and forget one-time thing. Okay, so now you can see I got the processes back that started with SVC. We have the PS computer name column here. It shows where they're coming from. Now, another key thing we can do is we can execute scripts in the same way remotely. So I've created a script here. Let's see. I'm going to get the content on it. All it does is it invokes getWMI object, gets a list of the logical disks, and displays them. Let's go ahead and use our invoke command. Localhost again. This time we're going to use the file path parameter. Give it a path to the script. Now this is really, really cool, because what's happening here is that on the remote machine, you don't have to set up, say, a central file share where everybody can access it to pull down the script. We're actually taking the script and we're sending it over the WSMAN remoting channel, over the PowerShell remoting, and executing it and then returning the results. So it's really, really powerful. And we get our results back. Okay, the next thing I want to show is this concept of PS session. And what a session allows you to do is allows you to create a persistent PowerShell remoting connection. And it's persistent so that we don't have to pay that penalty every time of, you know, connecting, spinning up the CLR, loading PowerShell engine, all of those things. We pay that cost once, and then we have a session created and it's persistent, and we can invoke multiple commands across it. We can also store state in that session. So if you need to, say, have variables stored across commands, then this is the way to go.
What I love about this PowerShell remoting part is that it's super flexible. You can do the fire and forget way that Dan demoed first, or you can do this whole session and get the persistence going so you don't have to keep, you know, connecting to that machine or passing the information.
Exactly. So what I'm doing here is I'm using the new PS session commandlet. This is how you create a persistent PowerShell connection. I'm just going to pass it a couple computer names, so both local hosts essentially, and assign it to our sessions variable. So each one of these, you can imagine this, you can do this across multiple different machines and have all these sessions open and active and assign it back to a common variable so that you can manage that. So let's take a look at our sessions. You can see we have two sessions. They're opened, and they are available to run commands. So now I can invoke a single command across all these sessions with one command. So I can say invoke command. I'm going to use the session parameter now. I'm going to pass it $sessions and a script block. And I'm just going to do a get process SVC host on that. You can see from the computer name, I have results coming back from both of the machines that I've specified from both of those sessions. And again, just to reinforce this, I can go ahead and I can invoke yet another command without against that same set of sessions because they're still active. So this time, let's just do a get command. Let's see, probably have a typo here.
Oh, it's $sessions?
Thank you.
Great.
So again, the connection is persistent with the PS session. I can get a list of my sessions with get PS session, and I can pipe it to remove PS session to clean those up. All right. Now, typically when you're doing these fan-out scenarios where you're trying to manage a large number of machines and you've invoked a script block or a script across a large number, typically you're going to hit an error. Something's going to fail. And in order to diagnose that, you're typically going to want to make a one-on-one connection to that machine and start to run some troubleshooting or some diagnostic steps. And this is where enter PS session comes in handy. So let me just show you what our current process ID looks like. So I'm going to do $PID, which holds our current PowerShell process. It has ID 5992. Now I'm going to run enter PS session, give it computer name localhost. And what enter PS session does is it creates a one-on-one connection over a PS session. This is, if you're familiar with Telnet, it's that type of experience where now you notice the prompt changed. It says localhost, tells me which computer I'm connected to. And now I can type commands as if I were at that machine, but it's going over PowerShell remoting. So if I do a get process again, you can see I have a different process ID. And in fact, the process name is different. It's going over, it has the WSMAN hosted process instead of PowerShell. And I can just type exit to get back to the local prompt. Let's go ahead and clean that up again. All right. So now let's say that I want to interact with multiple servers from a single local session. So for example, let's say I'm trying to manage totally different servers. Like I have AD over here, I have Exchange over here, I have SharePoint here, and I want to manage them all from my admin workstation. How can I do that? Well, what I can do is I can use what's called import PS session, which we call implicit remoting. What this does is it takes a command and it brings it into the current session, creates a proxy of that command, and then when you run that command, it goes over PowerShell remoting, and it's as if you had the command locally. So that allows you to import lots of different commands and use them from the same local session. All right. So that's PowerShell remoting. All right, now I'm going to turn over to Mir to talk about automating hardware and across firewalls.
Thank you. So that's actually a good point. One of the things we hear from you as well is, oh, yes? Yeah? That's a great question, actually, and you just gave me a great segue. I'm going to show you this in the next demo. Mix up WSMAN, and it involves that specific question you asked. So if you don't mind just bearing with me for 2 minutes, I'll show you. Thank you. So this is a good question because another thing we get very frequently from you is, you know, that's all great, but I also have hardware I need to manage, and a variety of hardware, heterogeneous devices running different OS versions, Windows, not Windows, and I need to work across firewalls. This is all awesome, but if I have a firewall, what do I do? So that's where WSMAN comes in. WSMAN is another one of these DMTF standards we were talking about earlier, and it stands for Web Services for Management. So this industry standard allows you to access SIEM just like WMI, but instead of using DCOM, we can use this protocol instead, and that is what gets you through those firewalls. You know, so you don't have that problem anymore. You don't have to worry about that anymore. So basically what WSMAN does is defining a set of server and client roles and a single set of operations that you can use consistently to manage those objects that you care about, your computers, your devices, just like we said earlier. works across firewalls. And another good thing is that there are several implementations of WSMAN. So you don't need to worry, you know, about choosing one and sticking with that. You can try a few, see the one that works best for you, and just stick with that. Another good thing is all these WMI classes I showed you earlier in the WMI demo are also exposed via WSMAN. So you can do the same type of things we did before. No need to worry about that. You just learn this one set of commands, and you're ready to go. That's another thing, like Dan was saying. You make the investment. Yes, there is some learning involved. But once you learn that, we leverage that and try to keep it going. You know, try to leverage your knowledge and get you through all these other worlds as well. And another thing is, you know, the PowerShell remoting demo that I just showed you, this is something we can do because we built some extensions on top of WSMAN that enable us to show you, you know, this great PowerShell remoting. So with that, basically, just to close on WSMAN, it's web services access to SIEM, but on heterogeneous devices and across firewalls. So this is funny because you see these two names, Smash and Dash, and it reminds me of comics, you know, like Bang, Bing, you know. But Smash and Dash, very simply, stands for how you manage across servers and clients. So Dash, the D is desktop, Smash, S for server, just to keep it simple. And how do you do that without having to care about, is there a firewall? Is the machine up or down? Is it put into the OS? You don't need to worry about that anymore. That's a great power of WSMAN. And you can do things like power the machine on and off, get the boot order, manage virtualization, the inventory of the software or the hardware that you have on that machine. Let's do pretty much everything. And another good thing is we have some members of the PowerShell community here. There are a lot of scripts that make it even easier to leverage the power of WSMAN. So you don't even need to learn the commands if you don't have time for that. So without further ado, let's just show you the architecture of this demo that we'll use to show you how you can manage machines across, you know, state, firewalls, etc. So we have the admin client on one side running the PowerShell client in this case. And the PowerShell client will talk to WSMAN by calling some WSMAN APIs. And those commands will be sent securely, this as in like SOAP messages, over HTTPS, or you can use HTTP as well. And they will get to the managed server where we have a WSMAN listener process on the server that you want to manage, or multiple servers, obviously, where there is a PowerShell client running. And the good thing about that is that once you get to your WSMAN host process, you know, each command is executed on its own host, on its own process, and its own PowerShell session. So one goes down, you can create another connection, talk to another one, you can have multiple of those running, etc. So let's get to the demo, because this is a really powerful demo. So you can see how WSMAN works in action. Just to make it simple, I'm not expecting you to be able to read what it says here. It's the end of the WMI demo. But basically, this is my client machine, where I manage from. Could be anywhere in the world. This is my server. Again, could be in San Francisco, Greece, I don't care. The idea is that I want to, from this client, work across all these firewalls, heterogeneous devices, and do something to this server machine over here. So to your question earlier, we actually get to your question. How can we deal with credentials and storing them? So I can create a PowerShell variable that will leverage this getCredential commandlet. And let's say I want to use it for the admin user. So here I get the credential prompt. Enter my password, close your eyes. And that is caching my password right there. And I saved it in this $cred variable. So what I want to do, first of all, is test WSMAN. So for that, we use the test WSMAN commandlet. And leveraging PowerShell remoting, I'm going to say, you know, on WSMAN remoting, actually, I'm going to say, you know, what computer I want to manage, which is this computer. So in this case, I'm going to enter the IP address, for the computer I want to manage. This is not localhost anymore. I'm actually managing another computer. And I get to choose even what authentication method I want to use. So in this case, let's go with Digest. I specify the port, which is 16992 for WSMan. And I'll pass it the credential that I just cached in dollar cred. So I have to say dollar credential, dash credential, dollar cred. And that's it. Those are the parameters I need. And here I can see, okay, yeah, you can actually get to that machine. And even more, it's telling me that's an Intel machine. And it has this thing, it says here, AMT 6.0. So basically what you need to be able to make this work, as you'll see in the demo, is this AMT. It's called a baseboard management controller, or you may have heard it as VPro technology from Intel. Different vendors implemented it. They call it different ways. Hilo from HP, you know, there are many different ones. So that tells me that I'll be able to do things across firewalls, and I'll be able to, you know, irrespective of the state of the machine, I'll be able to manage it. So the WSMan command we use for that is get WSMan instance, and I'm going to pass it the resource URI, basically specific SIM profile. As we said before, SIM has its schemas and the profiles. So I'm going to pass it this profile, and I'll specify again what computer name I want to use. And for that, I'm going to pass it the computer. The IP address could be the name of the computer I want to manage. So 192.168.0.1. I'm going to pass it the WSMan port again to tell it, you know, I'm doing WSMan here, 16992. And I'm going to pass it the credential, again, to your point on how you leverage those credentials once you store them. I'll use specific authentication method, again, digest. And then I'm going to say, you know what, enumerate all the profiles on that, all the profiles on that machine. I missed the letter I here in the resource URI. Sorry about that. One thing that I want to mention here also is this is case sensitive, SIM register profile. So any profile you pass, that's case sensitive. I learned that last year when preparing for the demo. Pass the credentials, dollar cred, and the authentication method, which is digest, and I'll say dash enumerate. So now it works. So basically, you can see everything that you have on that machine. ME stands for Management Engine. So in this case, we have Intel. Like I said, could be any vendor that implemented this. So you can see you have profile registration, role-based authorization, which we can tie back to the delegated administration comment we made earlier, the audit log, remote access, all the stuff I can do, KVM redirection, all the stuff I can do against this machine. So now, one thing that we want to show you is, you know, this is great. Again, as we said earlier, if you can get it, if you can get to that, if you have the time to learn all these parameters, you know, there are a lot. So one great thing about the community, WSMan, WMI, and PowerShell community, is that there are a lot of scripts out there that you can leverage to just, you know, run this with one command name. You don't need to remember, you know, dash enumerate, dash credential. That's a lot of work. Yes, you have a question? Yes. You can use 16993 for HTTPS. Yes, that's correct. Yeah. But it works across the firewalls, whereas the previous methods we showed, you can't even get them to work. So yes, there is the good point. There is the added work of having to open that port. That's correct, and the implications of that. But it works across those firewalls once you do that. Yeah, good question. Thank you. So what I was saying is, you know, you don't need to learn all that. If you want, awesome. If you don't have the time or you can't, you can use scripts from the community. So one thing I want to show you here is a specific script. We have ticket 11. So if we go here, you'll see we have a test script. Sorry, one thing. Test setup script. So I'll invoke that, and let me show you what it has. So you see there is no cheating involved. Another way, to your point again on the credentials, I could cache the credentials here. You can say, okay, this is my password, so I can have it just in this script, maybe in a location that only I can access and only a couple of admins can access. I'll store the password there and I'll say this is the username and the password using these commands. And then I'll specify the specific connection URI I care about, WSMan again, the authentication method. You know, I can make it really simple and then just give this to somebody else to try. So if we invoke this thing, then I can see what I can do with that using the PowerShell get command. So I can say, okay, you know what? I have a module here. Let me show you. If I do it there, I have a hardware management module. So one thing you can do here is do like get command dash module. Show me what I have in this module. So I see what I can do with it. So you see, you can clear the error log, you can get the boot order, you can get the power state for the machine, lots of different things. Again, you don't even need to build these scripts. You can download them, go to forums, you know, talk to the community, your user group, etc. So let's say I want to say, you know what, get me the boot order for my server, which is something I had in the script. And there I can see, okay, first it will do a CD. Again, remember, this machine could be in Thailand. I don't care where it is. I'm actually getting to see the stuff that I can do against this particular machine. So I see, okay, first boot is the CD, then Pixie boot, and then finally my hard drive. I can see the power state. Is the machine on or not? So I'll say get power state at server. And I can see, oh, the machine is on. That's great. So you know what? Let me set the power state. That seems more powerful. So I'll say set power state at server dash power state. Actually, let me show you what power states you can use first. So first of all, you can see, okay, I can turn it on, sleep light. Oops, sorry. I can do sleep light. I can do sleep deep, sleep tight, you know, whatever you want. Oops, sorry. Different modes. So now if I use the power state parameter, I can say, you know what? Off soft. So what I'm telling now to this machine is, you know what? Over WSMan, remotely, across all these firewalls, countries, I don't care, I want you to turn off this machine. Off soft is actually when you put it to sleep. So now I can wait for a few seconds and then it says true. And as you can see, this machine is blank. Again, you don't need to read, but before it was the blue PowerShell console. Now it's off. So let's confirm it's actually off. So I'll do again, get power state at server, this machine I'm managing, and I'll see, okay, let me see. Oh, off soft. Now the really cool thing is when you don't have to fly, drive to all these remote locations anymore, and you can turn your machine on from wherever you are. So now instead of using the set power state commandlet to turn it off, I'll turn it on. So what will happen is, over this wire, this will talk to the baseboard management controller on this server machine I'm managing, and it will say, you know what, turn on. And just keep your eyes here.
I hear it.
It takes a few seconds because it's actually connecting to that machine over the wire, sending WSMan commands over it. And it says true here on the PowerShell console. Let's see what happens here on the actual machine. So the first thing you see, you know, the ThinkPad boot, so it actually worked. I don't even need to fly there anymore, drive 2 hours to get to my servers. And even if your servers are in your same work location, typical feedback we get from you is, I don't have access to the server room, I don't even have TS access to it, I still need to get my job done, and this is how you can leverage WSMan to simplify your job.
Great demo. All right, switch back to the slide.
Yeah, now, there are a variety of machines you could have. It's not always a full server, the latest version of the OS. You could have things like server core running on your machine, right? So in that case, what do? You can still use WMI and WSMan to manage those machines. And once you first get it set up, the key thing you want to do with server core is enable remote access. You don't have the GUI there anymore. You're not at those machines. So we'll show you how you can use sconfig from the command line on that server machine to get the first setup tasks done, enable remote access, and then you can even leverage PowerShell now, starting with Windows Server 08, R2, or Windows 7, to manage those server core machines, just to make it even easier. So this new script called sconfig is going to help you do all those initial tasks that you always have to do, you know, like joining the machine to the domain, setting the network settings, even enabling remote access. So if you see number 4 there, it says configure remote management. Once you enter that option, you get the remoting specific dialog there where you can, well, dialog, it's a command prompt. But you get the options there where you can enable MMC remote management. So you can use things like the server manager console that you can install on a client like Windows 7 to manage that server core machine remotely. Or you can enable PowerShell even. Because server core now comes with .NET as an option, you can install server core, install .NET on it, and then you can even deploy PowerShell on that server core machine. So you can use the PowerShell remoting features that Dan was showing you earlier against even server core machines. So that's really, really powerful. And here, we don't have time to go through all of this, but here is just a summary of how you can get these tasks done, how you can install PowerShell from the command line on your server core machine, or you can use sconfig if you want. And then all this server manager and BPA, or best practices analyzer commandlets, then you can use even to install roles or features on the machine, if you prefer that. Or you can use the full server manager console from a remote machine to do the same tasks, if you prefer using a GUI-based application.
All right. Thanks, Mir. So then, next question we get usually, okay, fine. You got PowerShell in Windows 7. You got it in R2. That's really great. Finally, it's on by default. I can depend on it. And you've shown me how I can now manage server core by turning on .NET and turning on PowerShell. But who still has, say, Windows Server 2003 in their environments, right? Pretty much everybody, right? What about XP? Anybody still have XP? A few? Okay. So that's where the question we usually get is, okay, what do you have for me to do that, to manage those machines? And that's where the Windows Management Framework comes into play. Again, we have a downloadable package with the Windows Management Framework that's installable all the way down to XPSP2. And that includes PowerShell 2.0, includes the WinRM WSMan stack, and it includes Bits 4.0. So now you can use this whole stack all the way down to XPSP2 and have a consistent management experience.
I love that integration story as well, and down level story, because one of the things that makes us feel bad is when we have to come here and tell you, oh, you have this beautiful feature. Oh, by the way, you need the latest OS in order to use it. So it took us a lot of work to make this available to all of these down-level OSs, but I think it's really worth it because just the show of hands that you did, you know, when we asked you if you're still running XP or WSO3, just justifies, you know, all that work that we had to do. It's, yep. You can still leverage all these features. Yep. Yes? Sorry, SP3. Oh, right. Yeah, we forgot to update that. Good point. It's always the latest service pack. So it's still XP, you just need the latest service pack. Thank you.
All right, so then people are usually pretty happy with that, but then occasionally we get the question, well, I actually still have some Windows 2000 running in my environment. How many people have Windows 2000 still running on some boxes? So there's a few hands out there, yeah. What do you have for me in that case? And unfortunately, the management framework doesn't install there, but we still do have a story around that, and that's our commandlet remoting. As Mir mentioned with WMI, WMI is pretty old. I mean, it's over a decade old now, and WMI shipped with Windows 2000. And so because we have such great access to WMI from PowerShell, we can still leverage WMI to get to those machines. Also, with PowerShell 1.0, PowerShell 1.0 did not have the nice PowerShell remoting that you see with PowerShell V2. It had remoting was supported on the per commandlet level. So for each of the commandlets had to implement their own remoting. And that remoting was done over RPC or DCOM, depending on the commandlet. And so you can still manage Windows 2000 using some of these commandlets that support their own remoting. And you can find out which commandlets those are typically by finding which ones have a computer name parameter. So you can say git help dash parameter computer name, and you can see those. Those include things like git counter, that's like getting a list of performance counters, or git hotfix, get a list of the patches, event logs, services, WMI, etc. And with that, let me show you a little demo on this. Okay, so what I'm going to do first is I'm going to use git service. Again, this has a computer name parameter. This is one of the first commandlets we shipped. It shipped in PowerShell 1.0, and it does its own remoting over RPC DCOM. So it's not the nice firewall-friendly stuff you get with ubiquitous PowerShell remoting, but you can at least get to down-level machines. And I'm just going to go over localhost, name anything that starts with T. All right? Now, I have a list of computer names in a text file here. So similar to the other commandlets, most of these commandlets support an array of computer names. So again, you can do one-to-many management. So here I can say get service, computer name. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to get that content from that file by using this syntax dollar with parentheses. That just says tell PowerShell to run that piece and take the output and pass it as the value to the computer name parameter. Computers.txt, name T. So here I've read in a list of computer names, and I pass that to the get service commandlet, and I'm getting services from multiple machines. All right, let's see what type of object we get back from get service to see if we can do anything else with it. I'm going to pipe that to get member. All right, you can see this is returning a type system.serviceProcess.serviceController. You can see we can do a lot of things like close it, pause it, start, stop, refresh, etc. All right, let's take a look at another example. Get hotfix. So this gets a list of hotfixes that have been applied to both local or remote computers. So I can run that. And again, I can pass it an array of computer names. You can see that it's running multiple times. I'm using localhost here, but this first column here shows you which computer the result is coming back from, the source here. MSPW500, that's the name of this machine. Let's take a look at another one, get event log. This gets the events from the event log on local or remote computers. First, I'm going to get a list of the available logs. So these are the logs that I can manage. Now I'm going to get a particular log system, and I'm going to get the newest 10 entries from that log. Okay, now I've just been operating against the local machine. Now with the computer name parameter, I can do the same task against the remote machine. And I can retrieve a specific event. So let's get the newest 100, same command, and I'm going to use PowerShell's filtering with where object, dollar underbar, means get me the current object in the pipeline, and I'm going to access the index property on that object. And I'm just going to choose one of these, say 6263. So I can get a single entry. Now let's get a little bit more complex here, and let's grab the newest 1000. And now I'm just going to group those by message, sort in descending order, by count. I'm going to select the first 10, and I want property count and name. So now I'm grabbing from the event log, and I'm trying to see which are the most frequent ones. You can see that on this particular machine, The telephony service has been throwing a lot of events. So that's an example of how you can use commandlet remoting to actually manage machines all the way down to Windows 2000. That's pretty good. All right. Now how about some fun?
It's the fun part. By the way, we have some swags at the end. So we have stuff here if you want to stop by. Now this is the fun part, because one of the things that we try to do when we work with the PowerShell team, WSMan and WMI, is, you know what? At the end of the day, you're working for so long as IT pros, nights, weekends, hard tasks, you need to remember to have fun. So one of the things that we do as part of the PowerShell team is, whenever, there's a tradition actually in the team, whenever somebody has a new baby, they have to send the baby announcement in the shape of a PowerShell script. It's mandatory. Otherwise, you have to leave the team. So here what we're going to do is, we have a competition going on. It actually is a real competition. People try to, you know, do a better script than the last person that had a baby, and that's how it keeps going. So we have some neat scripts to show you. And the first one I want to show you here is, you know, I think I'm going to beat you with that.
I don't know about
yeah,
this.
Yeah, we'll wait and see, because this one, it's actually a week old. This was sent to the whole PowerShell team a week ago. So somebody had a new baby, it was a Dash girl, and the name, well, obviously for privacy reasons, we're replacing it, but let's say it's PowerShell B next. They sent Dash birth weight, you know, the actual weight, the height, everything you want to know about the baby, right? And another thing here is, you know, where it was born, Dash PS mommy, the name of the mom, this is from Hemant, one of our coworkers. So he decided to implement the new baby function, where you pass it the parameters that I just showed you above. That the top line is the usage, and then you have this function. This is how he coded it. And what happens if you get contractions? What do? Okay, you need to find a bug real quick, add the items from this text file, because obviously we are geeks, right? So we have to have text file with all the items I need to take to the hospital. And then start car, that's a new commandlet in case you want to use it. Destination hospital. About traffic, of course, but the fun part is within speed limit force. You know, you just run to the hospital. Now, you get to the hospital, you need to test the appropriate conditions for delivery, right? Is the baby ready to go? So Hemant was watching his wife with honest and newfound respect that she was trying to deliver this baby.
I think he's going to get some points for that one, probably.
Yeah. Now, let's give the details. You don't want the gory part, you know. Push the baby, pipe two, you know, out baby. Again, skip the details. You don't want the shouting, you know, and the pain. And get the baby girl, finally. Again, with honest. And I like, he's even cute. He says, Dash is scared. Isn't that cute? And it's actually his second child. With all the love. Otherwise, just return, you know, maybe you need to go back home or wait a little bit. And then parents need to approve the name. And I like how he differentiated between parents, approvers and participants. You know, I don't care, the family can say whatever they want, we choose the name. That's cool. And finally, you actually send this email message. Typical email message. I'll be oof, I just had a baby, etc. So how are you going
to
tell
that? That's pretty good. I think Hemant did a pretty good job. So let's check out another example. This is one that I sent out when I had my most recent baby. This was back in August. So this kind of tells a little bit of a story. So start with enter car, driver dad, passenger mom, 10:30 p.m., fast. Exit car at the hospital, 20 minutes later. Request the nurse, type baby delivery, pipe that to test for the baby. Right error, baby not found.
404.
Not good. All right, wait baby, time out for about 4 hours, test for the baby again. Right error, baby not found. Oh, not good. Okay, enter car. Driver dad, passenger mom, we're at the hospital. Time 2:30 a.m., speed, slow. Exit car, home, time 3 o'clock.
It takes you half an hour to get
takes
home?
Takes a half an hour. Start sleep, couple of hours. Ping dad, source mom, message, it's time.
Freak out.
Enter car, driver, dad, passenger, mom, location, home. Time, 5:30, speed, fastest. Exit car, hospital, time, 5:40.
So the 30-minute trip is in 10 minutes. Awesome.
Request nurse, type baby delivery, pipe to test baby. Find doctor, time now. Speed, fast, type OBGYN, pipe to install doctor. Push baby, dash force. New baby, yay. Format list. And there's our new baby. Boy, mom status, elated, tired. Dad status, thrilled, tired. Baby status, happy, healthy, hungry. What do
that's
you think?
That's good. That's pretty good. Now I think I'm going to win because I have one from, I think it's like 2-3 weeks ago, from Nana, one of the PowerShell developers. And he's a great developer. He actually wrote the script that runs.
Yeah. Unlike the previous two.
That's the funny part. So it's called Get Name. So this is the problem that Nana had. I don't know if you ever had to go to a baby name website. It's just so annoying. You have all the letters in the alphabet. You have to click on each of them. Then you see the names. Click on the name. Wait. Get the link. See the meaning of the name. And then you have, like, you know, thousands like that that you have to go through. That's a great task for PowerShell. Yeah. You know, automation.
Absolutely.
It's all about automation. And especially, you know, Nana is from India, so in the Indian culture, it's really important to choose a name that has a good meaning, something that is relevant for you and that, you know, you want to wish to the baby. So hopefully the baby will be that way. So he created this variable URL base so he can connect to this website and choose the desired base. He wanted a Hindu name, right? So he chose desired base Hindu girl names. And then you connect to that, and you can get just the name, the meaning, and the link. Because he didn't want all that other stuff on the websites, the ads, you know, the extra clicks. You just get the stuff you want, and then you run the script. Unfortunately, we don't have internet access here, but I promise you it runs. And then what you get is this Excel file. So he saved everything to CSV file. He saved everything to this CSV file with just the names, which are the first thing there, the meaning. So you can see, if you do Control F, I want an artistic child. So you can type artistic there, and then you get your name. You should call it Adal Nangai. Right, so that was awesome. That's actually, he actually used this script to choose the baby name with his wife. So yeah, are you going to top that? You
know? That's pretty good. What do you guys think? A script that actually runs to pick the baby name. That's pretty creative. All right, thanks, Miriam.
So we're going to close now.
So just to summarize, again, the list of questions, what we hear from customers when we talk to them, why and what do I automate? Automate to reduce costs, to increase quality and speed. What do you automate? Pretty much everything you can. How do I automate my IT operations? WMI, WSMAN, and PowerShell. How do I automate hardware operations and across firewalls? That's WSMAN. And how do I automate all of my machines, the Windows Management Framework? All right, and then we have, I want to reinforce that we have a really rich PowerShell community out there. We have a bunch of really great MVPs, and the community is really vibrant and growing rapidly. So if you need help, there are a lot of resources out there. This list is just a partial list. And at this time, I'd like to invite up on stage Thomas Lee, who is one of the key contributors to the PowerShell community, to say just a few words.
Well, I need a mic. Good afternoon. Come on, wake up. Get dash volume. thanks, Dan, for a quick 2 minutes. When I first saw PowerShell, it was September 2003, and it was one of the more exciting events in my personal career. I actually kind of got it, and I realized at that moment that if Microsoft was true to its normal form, it wouldn't be able to do everything. Nobody could do everything. And the only way for it to succeed was to do an even better job with PowerShell than the Linux community has done with Linux. And you know what? I underestimated how good it could be. The community out there never ceases to amaze me. If there's virtually anything you want to automate. You can't figure it out. There's someone in the community who's probably done it twice. If there's something you don't understand about PowerShell, there's at least a dozen people sitting there on Twitter right now waiting to help. There are thousands of scripts. There are books. There are websites. There are blogs. There are, you name the way people can contribute, there's somebody contributing to PowerShell. PowerShellCommunity.org is one of the overarching organizations. We got a little bit of money from Microsoft, thank you. We got a little bit of money from Quest, a few other of our great sponsors. But we exist to try and help and to expand the community. So if you're in fear or doubt or concern or anything, there are any social media mechanism, put the hashtag PowerShell up there. You'll find at least three people willing to help at all hours of the day and night. Now, I demonstrate this in my classes when I teach. I live in Europe, so the time zone differences are usually quite different. On average, when I ask a question on the Monday morning to demonstrate, it takes between 3 and 4 minutes to get a response.
Wow. That's
and
great.
I get responses from all over the world, literally. Usually at the time I'm up, it's the Indians and the Kiwis who are up, but later in the day, it's the Americans. It's amazing. So come to these sites. Come down and visit us on the PowerShell booth. A number of the MVPs will be there, and get PowerShell.
Thank you. Thanks, Thomas.
Thanks, Thomas. Really appreciate it.
We even have comics. If you see the last link down there, it's actually a PowerShell comic. So we're running out of time, but these are related sessions. We actually couldn't fit all the PowerShell WMI, WSMan, and just plain Windows management sessions that you have taken this week. But this is just an example. Hands-on labs on PowerShell and server management, WMI, WSMan again. And we actually have that booth in WSB section of the TLC. So please come visit. We have some swags also to give you. Feel free to come up front or if you want to ask any questions.
Thanks again. Appreciate your time.
Thank you.